Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Corporal Cannon, a Female Marine in Afghanistan, by Savannah Cannon, narrated by Savannah Cannon. To those who are still fighting, and to those who support them. Foreword. 2017, San Diego, California. I began writing this book largely as a form of self-therapy, one that forces the trauma victim, me, to walk through a difficult experience in as much detail as possible in a non-stressful environment. It took me a long time and several panic attacks, one putting me in the hospital with what I thought was a heart attack, to understand that I needed help. So, I tried to get help. I requested PTSD help from Veterans Affairs, the VA, 6 months ago, but never heard back. I requested help from an outside organization that took 4 months to get back to me, at which point I was turned off by their lack of professionalism. They had promised same-week assistance. I requested help from my doctor, who prescribed a sedative to which I eventually became addicted. I tried talking to a therapist who said Jesus would help me if I stopped doing such horrible things. I walked out of his office. I have lost friends to suicide. One hung himself in the garage and left 3 children fatherless. I have thought about swerving my car into oncoming traffic just to escape my own mind. But I have a son, and he deserves more than that. Depression is like standing in a pitch-black room full of dangerous objects that you cannot see. You know you should move around, live life normally, but the darkness is so heavy and pain follows any action. Even fumbling around for a light switch can hurt, because you may stumble into one of those dangerous objects. So, you become immobile. People always said, just come to me if it gets that bad. But when the pain is inside your head and radiates to your toes, no one can help. So, in a last-ditch effort to get better and to have nightmares less often, I finally understood that what I really needed to do was write. If this story is descriptive in parts and blank in others, it is because I wrote it as I remembered it. The language used in my account can be rough and in some places considered offensive. Today, I have a great life and I am safe. But I think it's time to address what happened during my Afghanistan deployment in 2010. Perhaps my words will help some of you realize that you're not alone in your pain, that you can also get better. Chapter 1. August 2010. Camp Dalaram, Afghanistan. I stepped into the tent and walked across the dusty floor to my bunk. My boots left imprints in the sand, so fine that they looked and felt like moon dust. No matter how often I swept, the desert always came back. My bunk bed was in the back left corner of an empty tent that was designed to hold over 30 bunks. The tents were giant containers shaped like soup cans that had been cut in half vertically and turned with the cut side on the ground. The metal frame was covered in a sandy-colored canvas designed to protect its inhabitants from the sun and other elements. The canvas did nothing to protect us from mortars. I slept in the same tent as the only other female Marine at Dalaram, Lance Corporal Sandwith. Her bunk was in the back also, and we had both hung extra sheets from our top bunks to enclose our sleeping areas at the bottom. Not that it mattered. We never saw each other. She and I were doing different jobs. Saw different people, slept at separate times, if we did sleep, and patrolled different bases with different enemies. I took off my rifle and sat on the bed. A blank wall stared back at me. Everything was the same color as the desert, a weird yellow tan. Even things that weren't that color were covered in the powdery sand and eventually melted into the never-ending landscape. I Googled pictures of fields when I was at work just to see some green. Sweat dripped from my face. If I sat too close to the edge of the tent, the canvas radiated 140-degree heat from the outside. But the edge of the tent was also where the air conditioning tube ran, which blew sometimes cooler than 140-degree air. I say 140 degrees because after 120 degrees, does it even matter how hot it really is? It was August, in the Middle Eastern desert, with no natural shade. It felt like Satan's asshole. Gazing listlessly at the wall, I fumbled for the 30-round magazine I kept in the right cargo pocket of my cami bottoms on my calf. We had to have ammo on us at all times, and since we weren't supposed to have our rifles loaded on base, most people kept their cartridges in that pocket. As I pulled the mag out, I looked at the scrape marks on the cartridge from the constant insertion and retraction that we practiced. The portion of the mag that had been scraped was a shiny, silvery color. The rest of it was black. Flipping the mag around in my hands a few times, I felt the familiar weight of 30 bullets. I picked my rifle off the ground and inserted the magazine. With a firm pull, I racked back the rifle's charging handle. It slid forward, and the bullet moved into place. I knew that when I pulled the trigger, the bullet would travel up through the chamber and meet its target. The mag would be lighter than usual to the person who picked up my rifle, and the casing for that bullet would be cast to the side, falling under my gear until the staff non-commissioned officer who would inventory my personal effects found it. After flipping the rifle safety from safe to semi with a quick snap, I gently placed the buttstock of the rifle between my legs and onto the ground. I slid both my hands around the top of the barrel. As my right hand slid down the rifle and towards the trigger, I felt the dust scrape against my fingers on the ridged plastic and metal. I placed the muzzle of the rifle into the bottom of my jaw and held the buttstock between my boots. Then I reached for the trigger. It was just barely out of reach, and my entire body was shaking as my arm strained downwards, trying to get to it. The seconds ticked by. I couldn't reach the trigger. Frustrated, I carefully, slowly laid the loaded rifle back onto my bed and slid to the ground. Opening my flight bag, I rummaged through my silkies until I found what I was looking for. Still shaking, I leaned against the edge of the bed, sitting in the sand on the tent floor, and looked at the positive pregnancy test in my hand. Chapter 2. 3 months earlier, May 2010. Camp Leatherneck, Afghanistan. In 2010, when I was 20 years old and a corporal in the United States Marine Corps, I deployed to Afghanistan. My military occupational specialty, MOS, was 0656, a tactical data networking specialist, aka a data dink. It was my job to give internet capabilities to Marine units as they invaded and occupied different areas of war. I had been at Camp Leatherneck, a huge base in Helmand Province, for almost 4 weeks when a group of data Marines were asked for volunteers to go do some things that would take us away from Leatherneck's eternal and predictable boredom. We were to be the network liaisons for a Georgian battalion that was trying to prove to NATO that they were allies, so NATO would protect them from Russia. Because Georgians didn't know how to operate the equipment that NATO had given them, we were to be sent in teams of two, to be embedded in the Georgian units and work the equipment for them. My hand shot up. That stupid little hand. Those last days before we left for the much smaller base at Delaram marked the last time I remember feeling innocent. I had done lots of things that would not be considered innocent, but I was still innocent in my heart. What took place in Delaram shotgunned me down a path that forced me to grow up. I ache now to think of who I was when I volunteered for the network liaison job and how unprepared I was for the rest of that deployment. Within 48 hours, 10 of us, 8 men and 2 women, loaded our bags into an Osprey helicopter. We left at night with 180 rounds of ammunition, a full combat load, and the flak jackets we carried on our bodies. The Kevlar helmet on my head pressed my tightly made bun down the back of my neck, straining my scalp and giving me a slight tension headache. I was excited, and I was naive. I spent the entirety of the hour-long flight watching the machine gunner hang out the back of the helo, swiveling the weapon back and forth in the darkness, while he and another Marine used night vision goggles to look for attackers on the ground. As we approached Delaram, the tension increased. The turret gunner hung out of the lowered ramp. "Hold on tight, we have to avoid some Hodges." Suddenly, the whir of the engine became a squeal, and the Osprey tilted back with its nose in the air. Our unsecured bags in the center shot out of the back of the helicopter and disappeared into darkness. The machine gunners were pissed as they dodged the falling bags we had lunged to try and save. The Osprey swung back and forth, faster and faster, left and right. The squeals got louder and louder. There was a reverberating thud as the Osprey hit the ground. "Get the fuck out and hurry," someone on the flight crew yelled at us. The 10 of us grabbed what was left of our gear and exited the back of the Osprey. The helicopter took off swiftly, dusting up clouds of sand that momentarily blinded us. I clenched my eyes closed and put my head down. Once the dust cleared, we looked up and peered into the darkness. We had been dropped off on a giant rock with nothing around. I didn't know if we were inside the base or outside, or whether we should have our weapons raised. I asked the sergeant what to do. I was the only corporal, and the lance corporals were looking at the sergeant and me, ready to follow our lead. Fuck if I know. There were no lights. We were alone, on a rock, in the darkness, without any idea of where we were or what we were supposed to do. "Hey, Corporal, here are our bags." We followed the voice through the darkness and gathered the lost bags from around the rock. There was movement off to the right. My heart jumped into my throat and I began to raise my weapon, my finger ready to switch off the safety. Until I saw a Marine coming towards us. "Hello, gents. Welcome to Dilaram." Chapter 3. May 2010, Camp Dilaram, Afghanistan. We were brought to a can to drop off our gear, and we left everything except our weapons. Leaving the flak, Kevlar, combat load, and multiple bags made me feel a billion times lighter. I grabbed a single magazine with 30 rounds of ammo and placed it in the cargo pocket of my right leg before leaving the can. The Marine who had walked out to the landing rock gestured for us to follow him up a hill towards another set of tan tents. I ran to keep up with his long stride. Antennas of all different shapes and sizes stuck out of the ground, some haphazardly held up with bits of wire and tied to stakes. I noticed a lightweight multi-band satellite terminal behind one of the tents, and tons of cables ran across the ground from tents into other tents. Sometimes piles of sand covered the cables. These tents were located inside a secure compound within the base, where access was restricted to communications Marines, contractors, and higher-ranking officers. The compound covered about 2 acres and was surrounded by 12-foot-tall concrete barriers. There was a wooden building immediately to the right within the entrance to the compound. It had a wide porch that had become a smoke pit for the nicotine addicted. A tall, dark-haired contractor stood on the porch, leaning on his elbow, with his right foot up on a bench, steadily dragging on a cigarette as he watched us walk by in the darkness. He met my curious gaze, and I held it longer than socially acceptable, partially looking over my shoulder at him as we crossed in front of his building. The contractor smiled at me, and I quickly looked away. I hadn't seen many other contractors in civilian clothes, and this attractive one caught me by surprise. Weeks of seeing only Marines had made me unused to anything other than men in camis with high and tights, and their faces all ran together. But this man, with his longer hair and khakis, stood out. We were used to the check-in ordeal that every Marine endures when checking into a new unit. All of us had secret clearances and dealt with access restrictions regularly. We were escorted through the compound to a larger tent called the Command Operations Center, the COC, to meet the Marine Major in charge of the base and the unit. His blue eyes scanned the 10 of us lined up in front of him. When he saw the female Lance Corporal and me, he sighed in disappointment and studied me sternly. "You're a girl." "Yes, sir." "You're not supposed to be here. This is a regimental combat team. There are no women here." The Lance Corporal and I stared at him blankly. What could we say? "Sorry about that, sir. We'll start walking." "We can't get the Ospreys back now. You're stuck here. But you two listen very carefully. You were never here. You will not bother the men. You will, under no circumstances, do anything unprofessional." The male Marines in the tent, my subordinate male Marines, looked at us out of the corners of their eyes as they stood at ease in front of the Marine Major. I felt my face getting hot. Yes, sir. As soon as we get some assistance from Camp Leatherneck, you two girls are going back where you belong. Do not talk to anyone. With that said, the 10 of us were dismissed. That's stupid. They had our names on the roster that was sent to them before we came here. Does Savannah sound like a masculine name? What a waste. Because I'm a girl? Don't they just need trained Marines? We left the tent, and I saw the contractor still on the wooden porch. He lit another cigarette as we passed. The red tip glowed in the darkness. Over the next few days, Lance Corporal Sandwith and I watched the 8 male Marines who had traveled with us get ready to be inserted into the Georgian battalions. She and I were placed in a temporary tent on the back edge of the living quarters, which had multiple empty tents surrounding it. No one could approach our tent without a solid 3 minutes of exposure in a known empty part of the living quarters and certain questioning about their intentions and gossip. The other Marines were getting acquainted with the Georgians. They were busy day in and day out, attempting to learn the Georgian language, a dialect of Russian. They questioned the Georgians on what they knew and what the plans were for the next few months. When the Georgian liaison Marines saw the Lance Corporal and me, they'd boast, "Hey, we're super busy, but this operation's gonna be awesome." Then they'd dash away. She and I weren't allowed to meet the Georgians or see the equipment we had been sent to work on. We ate alone, with the combat team Marines watching our every move. We waited for the Ospreys. I read in my tent, laying on my bottom bunk that had the most heavenly mattress. Rumors were that the Air Force had extra mattresses, and somehow they had ended up on this tiny forward operating base. Either way, that mattress was better than mine at home, and infinitely better than the thin, hard pads we had on Camp Leatherneck. The white comforter was just fluffy enough to add some softness to the harsh desert environment. I was too conditioned to be combat ready to remove my boots when I laid on the bed. You can't be too comfortable, you know. So I dangled my feet over the metal end of the bottom bunk and propped my book on my legs to read. 3 days into the stupor of boredom, we were awoken by a loud knock on the door of our can. "Get up. You're wanted in the COC. The Lance Corporal and I shuffled to the door and began to trudge up the sandy hill to the protected compound. I glanced at the smoke pit as we walked by. It was empty. We were led into a room with the major and two higher staff members. "The Ospreys aren't coming. You won't be going back to Camp Leatherneck. You will be placed in respective sections to your jobs, and you will work here." He seems pretty upset to keep us here. This is exactly like when Gunny Brown removed me from the Mew. He was known to remove girls from his unit's deployments because he didn't want trouble. I bet this major asked for different and male Marines and was told to pound sand. Good. The major looked disgruntled as he gestured to the two men. "Lance Corporal, you will be with Staff Sergeant Wilkins working on satellite communications." He looked at me. "Corporal, you will be with Staff Sergeant Rambo in the networking section." Looking back and forth between us, he grew even firmer in his next statement. "Remember what I said about behaving." It looked like we were there to stay. Chapter 4. May 2010, Camp Dalaram, Afghanistan. My second week on Dalaram was a blur of faces, numbers, and equipment. Getting accustomed to a new network is always overwhelming, and this newly implemented and ever-growing network was no exception. The combat team had reached this base a few months earlier. It was completely empty when they arrived. Over the past few months, the Marines had erected a lot of tents, and the Navy Seabees, aka Construction Battalion Seabees, had constructed a few buildings. The network team was small, maybe only 5 men total. They were forever roving to other combat bases where broken communications needed fixing. With so few knowledgeable people and an ever-expanding base, the network team was overworked. I was necessary. One of the men on the team, Wesniewski, remembered me from communications school in 2008. I remembered him only vaguely because he was in a different class, and there were about 200 men to every girl. The comradeship was slim in the desert, and we became fast friends. Ski made me laugh, caught me up on the network and things I needed to know, and essentially set me up for professional success. The platoon was offering an opportunity to get a gray belt in the Marine Corps martial arts by training sessions held at various times of the day. I was stoked and immediately signed up to be tossed around by men twice my size. I needed some way to stay in shape, and running was almost impossible on the small base, unless you wanted to run in tiny circles. I missed the miles of road on Leatherneck, where I regularly ran at night. The martial arts training was in a giant green tent with a tall ceiling. Torn up rubber, and of course, sand covered the ground. Everyone dropped their blouses, and in our boots, cami bottoms, and green skivvy shirts, we practiced takedowns and hand-to-hand combat. On the first day of practice, my partner, who is over 6 feet tall, threw me from his shoulder. The person getting thrown is supposed to land properly to prevent injury. I did not land properly. Besides having the wind knocked out of my lungs for what felt like eternity and feeling like I was going to vomit, I had landed sharply on my elbow. I felt a snap, an excruciating pain. Years later, it would be discovered that I had shattered a bone in my elbow. But a combat zone doesn't have time for frivolous injuries. Less than 2 weeks in this unit and I would be going to medical? Heck no. I wouldn't let them see me seek medical assistance and shake their heads. Typical broken female Marine, worthless unless they're on their backs. I gingerly got up and kept training, occasionally wiggling a shard of bone across my elbow and feeling the pain grow. Later in the week, the black belt instructor grappled with every single person attempting to get their gray belt. It was part of the program, and I was nervous. Mr. Black Belt had about 5 inches in height and 50 pounds on me. Not too bad, right? Well, he was skilled. It took approximately 10 seconds before I was down and pinned with my head squarely between his thighs. He began squeezing harder and harder, and as I began to black out, I turned my head to their right and bit the shit out of his leg. He yelped and released me, shoving me away from him and springing to his feet. Everyone circled around us, flipped out, shouting and jumping up and down in excitement, mocking the instructor for getting beat by a girl. She won! That's complete bullshit and inappropriate, Corporal. He was furious. If I had been a man, he would have decked me. As it was, he scolded me and went on and on about how inappropriately I had acted in front of about 20 male Marines. I left that session alone. Everyone, even Ski, avoided me, as if the instructor's fury at me would rub off on them. I walked back to my can, my rifle smacking my leg with every step. I was furious with myself. My actions had isolated me further from the men who were supposed to be my brothers. Every smack on my leg felt deserved and painful, yet not painful enough. Chapter 5. May 2010, Camp Dalaram, Afghanistan. Incoming! Ski and I jumped up and grabbed our rifles. Panicking, I tripped over my folding chair and began sprinting to the entrance of the tent. Quick, this way! We ran into the concrete bunkers that were immediately next to the networking tent. The bunkers had two long sides and a roof made of a slab of concrete. The sides were lined with green sandbags to our shoulders. I leaned against the edge of the bunker, gasping for breath as other Marines and contractors piled inside. A lean whistle began, growing louder and louder, shriller and shriller until it hit. The explosion was very close. The ground shook and dust fell from the concrete slab over our heads. Bet they missed. Those motherfuckers are shooting shitty mortars out of the back of trucks and can't hit the broadside of a barn, someone joked from the other side of the bunker. Everyone chuckled nervously. The contractor from the smoke pit was standing beside me. We tried to keep some space between us and the crowded bunker. His white collared shirt was a sharp contrast to the tam camis we were wearing. When more Marines showed up on the edge of the bunker, everyone pressed closer together to give them room. The contractor and I leaned against each other, my face extremely close to his chest. He smelled like warmth and man, the kind that makes you hunger for more. I gazed up at the slab overhead. If we get hit, that 2-ton slab is going to land on us. The contractor watched me, correctly interpreting my fear and suspicion of the engineering design of the bunker. It's an illusion of safety. If we get hit, they can report that we had taken cover. Oh, fantastic. Another whistle, an explosion. More dust settled on our heads. When your life is in danger, The environment becomes strange, almost surreal as you look around and become hyper-aware. You can't do anything to protect yourself, so you laugh. You make inappropriate jokes about the Marines who came to the bunker half-dressed. My fear of dying in a bunker under roof collapse drove me to press up against the tall and strong man right in front of me. I wanted to feel his chest rise and fall with mine as we awaited our fate. When the people around me shifted, the cute contractor looked down at me as I was pushed closer to him. "I'm William," he said. "And I can barely breathe," I said as I gasped for air in the tight space. Afterwards, everyone trudged back to their individual working areas. The explosions had hit the compound directly next to ours, about 100 meters from where I was sitting when the first mortar struck. That compound was the Afghan National Army, ANA base, where the Marines were supposed to train the Afghans to fight against the Taliban. The mortar men had hit the attacker's own countrymen. At the end of my workday, I walked back to my sleeping tent and took a detour to the ANA compound to see the damage. An ANA soldier told me what had happened when I walked up. He wouldn't let me see the area that had been attacked, forcibly shoving me away. Two men had died, hit by the mortars, while on the porta shitter. Their legs had been blown off while they were squatting to take a crap. The ANA soldier spoke to me scornfully. They were aiming for your tent. They wanted to take out the... He gestured to the satellite antennas. They would have never killed those men. They are our brothers. Fuck you, and fuck America. He spat at my feet. Shaken, I walked to my tent. Chapter 6. May 2010, Camp Dalaram, Afghanistan. After the mortar attack, I was extremely jumpy. The Afghan National Army soldiers glared at the Marines when we walked by. We were encouraged to walk with a battle buddy after reports came in of a member of the ANA stabbing a Marine in the neck at Camp Leatherneck. But ever since the McMap incident, I walked alone. The ANA was a complicated unit of men. Many of the soldiers were known affiliates of the Taliban, whom we were fighting. They made no attempt to hide their meetings with the Taliban before casually walking onto our base, going to our tiny chow hall, and sitting down at the tables next to us as we ate the same food. However, American policy was to train them and teach them to build up their own forces, knowing that they were passing information to our enemy. I don't believe these men were bad. They needed a job, and the ANA provided the means for them to earn a living. And we Americans were in their country and trying to kill their family members. War is not black and white, especially when it has twisted politics and purposes over hundreds of years. I had known nothing of the war in Afghanistan when I was sent to fight it. Like most Marines, my job was to support the few Marines who would kill the enemy. These men were called grunts, and I was a pogue, a derogatory term for personnel other than grunt. Not only was I a pogue, I was a girl. I wanted to call home after the attack, hoping my husband Adam could reassure me. I hadn't called home since arriving at Camp Dalaram nearly 2 weeks before. It was extremely difficult to place a phone call in a combat zone, even as a communications Marine. I was lamenting to Ski about the lack of contact with my husband, who hadn't emailed or sent me anything during my entire deployment. Ski led me to a tent filled with communications gear stacked high in green tactical boxes. On one of the boxes, there was a single phone going into the equipment. "Don't tell anyone about this phone. We don't have it registered to be taken down during River City." River City is a state of communications that the command imposes when it doesn't want information leaving an area of operation. This state can be implemented during times of serious operations or death. When an American dies in combat, all communication with the outside world stops. No email, no internet, no phone, no contact. This is to protect American families from learning that their family member has died from anyone other than the death detail who knocks on the front door. This dreaded knock is how families are to be notified, not by some shell-shocked Lance Corporal who was a family friend. So, this phone was off the grid. It was a fantastic secret. Make it quick. I reached for the piece of paper in my pocket that had the 14-digit phone number to a call center in Germany. I dialed and then waited with static in my ear for the operator to pick up. "I'd like to connect to an American phone center." I have been told to ask specifically for a center in Ohio that allows calls from a combat zone and didn't charge international fees. Please hold. 5 minutes went by as my call was connected to another operator. I shuffled uncomfortably on the floor of the tent. I would like to call area code 760. When I heard the dial tone, I dialed my husband's number. He picked up on the fifth ring, and I heard sounds of a party in the background. Hey, I haven't heard from you in a while. There was a horrible 10-second lag before I heard him respond. Yeah, I've just been relaxing after my deployment. He had gotten back from his 8-month-long deployment aboard a naval ship 2 days before I left for mine. We had been married in December of 2008. An open marriage was his idea, and I had agreed. The idea intrigued me as a Southern-raised Christian. There was a lot of cheating anyway in military relationships because of the long years spent apart. So the idea of ethical non-monogamy with a solid base of trust and love appealed to me. It reassured me that we could do this and come out on the other side. But as time went on, I became less sure of this and expressed my doubts to him as my jealousy of his actions had grown. Yeah, well, things have been pretty rough here. I bet. Giggles from a girl came through the phone. Adam, I thought we said we weren't going to swing anymore. Yeah, I'm not sure I want to not swing. Oh. Well, I'm going to go jump in the hot tub. Talk to you later. Click. I had a horrible, heavy feeling in my stomach. I set down the phone and got up from the uncomfortable position I had been in on the floor. When Ski asked if everything was okay, I just shook my head as hot tears collected dust down my face. I walked past him and out of the tent. Later that day, mail was delivered. Everyone's names were called out by some random lance corporal in charge of mail. Letters and packages were tossed to their recipients. Some 50 names were called out, and mine was not one of them. Here's one for William. My ears perked up. I waited for him to walk by. He came from the back of the room, grabbed his package, and grinned at me as he passed. I turned beet red and looked at my boots. His smile made my heart skip. When my 12-hour shift was over, I was leaving the compound and saw William sitting on the porch of the operations center, smoking. He waved at me and I walked over to him. Hey, William. Hope you got some cool stuff from home. You know what? Fuck Adam. Fuck him and that bitch he's fucking. Yeah, come here. I'll show you. I walked towards him. Chapter 7. May 2010, Camp Dalaram, Afghanistan. William and I became extremely close over the next few days. We sat on the porch in front of his workspace where I had seen him smoking that first day and talked until 2 a.m. about life, politics, religion, our families, and our upbringings. I told him about my husband and how I didn't want to swing anymore, but he was indulging in whatever he wanted while I was gone. When I told William, my head sank and my eyes drooped to my lap. I didn't talk for a few minutes. He looked down at me, seeming to ponder something. Wait here. He walked over to his work building, unlocked the door, and walked in, leaving me outside. I had no reason to be inside of his work area, so I waited patiently. Deployment teaches you a lot about yourself and those you are deployed with. There aren't any cell phones to pull out in time to the slightest boredom. If you want to read a book to pass the time, you need to carry that book with you at all times, because boredom is a random occurrence. Books were uncommon on base and limited to the few that people passed around, like the copy of World War Z, which was dog-eared after being read by every single person in communications. I had brought a few books from Camp Leatherneck and had read them all within the first week. My ebook reader needed a firmware update that I couldn't download in another country, so I couldn't access those books. Losing books felt like losing my best friends. Without distractions, you are subject to a lot of introspection. If you were lucky enough for someone else to be around, you get to know each other pretty well. Theories about the world's purpose, religious arguments, and discussions about which celebrity's dirty bathwater you would drink from after a bad bout of diarrhea were all too common. The right answer is Natalie Portman, not Taylor Swift, Norrid. No topic is left untouched in a group of Marines. Remember a time before cell phones? people would rely on television to zone out when they were gathered in groups. Well, in Afghanistan, we had our personal laptops, if we were lucky enough to have brought one. But laptops broke after so much exposure to sand and being thrown around in our packs. Without an electronic store around, even the communications Marines couldn't keep their computers operational. As it was, my laptop barely lasted the deployment after the fan broke. We didn't have internet access beyond what the military allowed us to have, which was extremely slow and not worth using. So we watched videos on the Universal Share Drive. That share drive was where everyone dumped their copies of shows like Weeds, music like 303, and all their porn, in the folder named Prawn. When everyone had uploaded what they had, they downloaded what they wanted to see. To this day, I can't listen to 303 without getting transported to the desert sands of Afghanistan. William walked back from his work area and showed me a picture of a baby. This is my daughter, Amelia. We call her Amy. She had the most adorable rolls of fat around her ankles. He looked down at her proudly and asked if I wanted children. Of course, I can't wait to have a baby of my own. Good. I turned red and changed the topic back to Amy, cooing over those adorable rolls. Chapter 8. May 2010, Camp Dalaram, Afghanistan. A few hours after my conversation with William, I was walking out of the network tent towards the exit of the compound to eat lunch by myself when I heard the thud of boots come up quickly behind me. I wheeled around in alarm, just in time to see a flash of Ski's face before he picked me up and threw me over his shoulder. Laughing and smacking him, I screamed at him to put me down. Some other Marines joined him when he set me down. "Want to go eat with us?" "Yeah." We set off towards the tent that doubled as a chow hall. "Hey, Marines!" We immediately stopped in our tracks and turned towards the voice of a very angry major. "What is going on here?" "What do you mean, sir? Why are you laughing?" Ski stepped forward. I was playing around with her and we..." "Stop," the major snapped at me. "You, keep walking." I turned around and headed towards the exit, confused and embarrassed, while the three male Marines were reprimanded by the major. William came out of his building and asked if I was heading to eat. I said yes and joined him on the walk down the hill. My thoughts of the others were dispelled until I saw them in the chow hall later. "Ski, what was that all about?" "Go away. We can't talk to you." "What? Why?" "Just go away." Ski refused to meet my eyes as he spoke. He turned around and left me standing in the center of the tent with my food tray in my hands. When I went back to work, Staff Sergeant Rambo called me next to his desk. So, some changes have to be made, and it's been decided you'll work nights from now on." "Alone, Staff Sergeant? Why? What did I do?" "Yes, alone. And it's because of, circumstances." He trailed off and shuffled the papers on his desk. This was clearly a conversation he didn't want to have. So, take off now and be back at 1900 to start your shift." "Yes, Staff Sergeant." As I left the tent, I heard the other Marines complaining. "Man, I wanted night shift. Skate life. Fuck her. Girls always get special treatment." I assumed Ski would catch me up later on what the major had said to them after our episode of laughter. I went to my shift, conducted changeover with the guy I was relieving, and began my work. Around 9 at night, Ski walked in and mumbled at me to meet him in the martial arts tent. As he swiftly exited the tent, I gazed around at the other Marines working nearby to see if I'd be missed. No one was paying any attention to me, as they were indulging in season 4 of Weeds. I walked out into the clear night and entered the martial arts tent. "What the hell, Ski?" "Look, everyone was brought together and told not to interact with you at all. Perception's reality, you know? Female Marines are whores, right?" I was open-mouthed at his explanation. "But I haven't done anything. I've been here 2 weeks." "Yeah, but everyone knows women in a grunt unit are trouble. I guess the major has had some bad experiences and he doesn't want you here. Since he can't get rid of you and we need you to do networking, he doesn't want anyone to be anywhere around you. And he said he would question anyone who was." "But..." I had no idea what to say. "A combat zone needs camaraderie. Just the idea of a brotherhood is sometimes the only thing that can keep up morale.
Look.
He thinks we're fucking. I laughed. That's ridiculous.
Is it?
Ski stepped towards me, closing the space between us. He took his hands and grabbed the backs of my arms, pulling me closer. Ski, no, you're my friend. I stepped away. The look that passed over his face was one of shock and almost immediate anger. He seemed to grow taller as he spun on his heels and left in a rage. I knew you were a whore. Standing in the martial arts tent, with the ground-up rubber under my feet, I had never felt so alone. Chapter 9. June, 2010, Camp Dalaram, Afghanistan. My favorite time of the day is early morning between 0300 and 0400. In America, it's quiet. The roads are empty. The dew begins to form as the moisture in the air chills to its coldest point and settles on the leaves. Everyone is asleep, and I'd be awake with the quiet in my thoughts. In the summertime desert, that time of day is perfect. It is the coldest that it will be that day, around the high 80s, and the desert cold is crisp and clear. The air smells faintly of dust, but it's a clean dust, undisturbed by sweat and heat. Hot day dust is damaging, an active swirl of destruction. Morning dust is cool and calm. The Afghan 0300 sky is very different from an American suburb 0300 sky. In America, it is pitch black and quiet. In Afghanistan, the sky begins to lighten at 0300 in shades of brighter and brighter purples and pinks, fading into oranges and yellows. The sky becomes filled with the sun by 0500 and remains that way, unrelenting in its heat and strength, until 1900 or so. The horizon was unmarred by any buildings or trees. Only on really clear days, I could see rock-covered mountains in one direction far in the distance. Otherwise, the sky was completely open and vulnerable to me at 0300. The colors filled the sky, and I'd watch in awe until the sun broke the horizon and I could no longer look for the glare. On a typical morning, I left my night shift temporarily and headed to breakfast before the sun rose, so that it gently warmed my back as I walked to the chow hall. By the time I was done with breakfast, the harsh and extremely bright sun was in full force. My first night on night shift, I walked to breakfast alone. William saw me come into the tent that housed tables and chairs in lunchroom style and waved me over, glad to not eat alone after my encounter with Ski only hours prior. I walked over and immediately started the conversation. So, who is Amy's mother? She is someone I was dating and got pregnant. She became crazy once she was pregnant and started doing weird things like sitting in her car outside of my house and insisting that we were together. The whole thing was a mistake. But Amy is amazing. I only want more children. So she has Amy? My family takes care of Amy when Cynthia doesn't have her. Why didn't you stay with Cynthia? My mother doesn't like her, and she honestly acted so crazy. I'm trying to get full custody, which is why I'm here in Afghanistan, to get enough money and give Amy a good life. I bought a house in Arizona. It needs a womanly touch. William gave me a pointed look. I laughed. Well, I have been told that I make things very homey. We finished eating together and walked back to the compound. I had a few more hours on my shift, and his shift started soon. Hey, grab me before you leave to go to sleep, and I'll walk you back. I nodded gratefully and left him on the porch as I walked towards my work tent. I spent the rest of my shift thinking about what would happen when he walked me back to my very isolated tent at the back corner of the camp. Would he kiss me? There was no denying that we were attracted to one another. I could tell by the way he looked at me the night I had arrived, and how he reacted when I leaned into his chest during the mortar attack. Shaking from the possibility of the unknown, I walked up to his building at the end of my shift and knocked on the door. He popped out and cheerfully asked if I was ready to sleep. Yeah, I didn't sleep at all yesterday during the 4-hour warning I had prior to the abrupt change to night shift. As we walked to my tent, I filled him in on what had transpired between Ski and me. So, you weren't fucking him? No, Jesus, does everyone think that? Don't take the Lord's name in vain. He doesn't like it. He grinned at me. Not knowing if he was serious, I kept walking. All these tents are empty. I think they wanted to make sure the two of us girls were very isolated from the men. William looked around in surprise. All of these tents are empty? Yeah. He went to the closest one and threw the door open. He gestured for me to follow him as he stepped in. Here it is. This is it. And who cares? If everyone thinks I'm fucking everyone, I might as well do what I'm getting accused of. I'm already getting ostracized. I walked in and glanced around quickly before the door swung closed, shutting out all light. There were unused bunk beds scattered randomly around the tent. William stood in the middle, watching me. In silence, he walked towards me, stopping centimeters from me. He was more than a foot taller than me, even when I was wearing my combat boots. I felt like a child next to him. He bent down and kissed me hungrily. I kissed him back, and we exploded in a flurry of touching, exploring each other's bodies. He bent down and picked me up, and I wrapped my legs around him. Are you on birth control? No. As he carried me over to one of the beds, I completely stopped thinking, enjoying all of it. I'm gonna get you pregnant. I was so caught up in the moment and the feel of him that what he said registered only on a primal level. It turned me on, and I didn't react until seconds later when it was too late. When he came, filling me up, I was horrified. William, I'm not on birth control. You said you wanted babies. Like, in a year or so, not in the middle of a combat zone. I said I was going to get you pregnant. You seem to like it. William. I like it when you call me that. A lot of people shorten my name to Will, but you always call me William. He grinned at me. Shaking, I pulled my pants back up. My boots had never made it off. Tucking in my shirt, I grabbed my rifle from where it had fallen in the midst of the passion. Without speaking, part murderous, part terrified, and with my body still turned on and breathless, I left the tent, exposed in the harsh sun. William followed. Chapter 10. 2017, California, USA. I found out on Saturday that one of the Marines I had worked with in Japan had killed himself. He was walking down the stairs during an argument with his wife and blew his brains out all over the stairwell. He had been going through some things in the Marine Corps. He had gotten in trouble and had been demoted. The police suspected his wife, until they discovered a suicide note at his work. This tall, goofy, adventurous, and loved Marine had thought about killing himself so often that he had actually written a note while at work. Then he went home and got into an argument with his wife, with suicide already planned as an escape route. It wasn't a spur-of-the-moment decision. He had been suffering inside for so long that he had a plan and the means to execute that plan. We all get angry when our military friends kill themselves. Why did he kill himself just because he got in trouble? Marines have gotten in trouble since the beginning of time. We were born in a bar, and we kill people for a living, for Christ's sakes. He's just being a weak pussy. We'd never have allowed hard times in the Corps to cause us to kill ourselves. Fucking pussy. But decades ago, getting in trouble didn't end your career like it does now. One slip up and you lose everything you've worked on for years, including education benefits, the ability to re-enlist, the respect of your peers, and more. There is no more taking them to the tree line and beating the shit out of a Marine to teach him a lesson before cracking open a beer and settling the issue. Marine discipline is conducted through paperwork, and paperwork has more lasting effects than a good beating in the woods. To be faced with the utter destruction of your career and loss of respect after years of sacrifice is heart-wrenching for some Marines, when all they wanted was to drink a beer after seeing their buddies blown apart in Iraq and Afghanistan. Instead, they got caught drinking underage, or perhaps sneaking a girl into the barracks to have some much-needed sex. There's life outside the Marine Corps. Well, yeah, of course. But young Marines don't see life outside of the Marine Corps, because that is all the majority have known in their adult lives. I certainly knew that world-ending feeling when everything fell apart for me in the Marine Corps. It felt like the slim foundation on which my young life had been built was crumbling under my feet, and no matter how fast I scrambled, I couldn't find a firm ground to stand on. How could I survive with nothing to support me? I'm angry about this Marine killing himself, but I'm also not surprised. I'm not surprised because at least once a month, someone I know kills themselves. Sometimes they are faces that I've seen and served with, but I don't remember them vividly. Other times, they are really close to me, and I try so hard, and yet not hard enough, to keep them alive. The numbers are increasing, and not just with combat veterans. I think the main reason I'm so angry about his death is that I know what he was experiencing because I experienced it myself, and yet I haven't given in to it. I'm angry that I continue to suffer, and he isn't suffering anymore. I'm angry that when I get suicidal, it's like my brain is on fire, white hot with rage and disappointment and pain. I feel trapped in my own brain, smashing against the walls of my mind, screaming, and the only thing that calms me down is the thought of killing myself to end it. I'm angry because he gave in, while I just danced around it in my head. Till Valhalla, Marine. Chapter 11. June 2010, Camp Dalaram, Afghanistan. When did I get my period last? Was it April? May? Fuck, I don't remember anything. Is it June already? Yes, it's June. Okay, I got to Dalaram like 3 weeks ago in May, and did I have my period on Leatherneck? Maybe? Fuck, I know I got it like twice, but everything runs together like one giant Groundhog Day here. Okay, so we left America March 3rd, landed at Manas on the 4th, and I got here on like the 30th? So the next one was April 25th-ish, and then May. Oh, right, I got it here, on Dalaram. May 20th-ish. God damn it, why don't I know when I got my period? Why don't I track this shit? I always hate surprise bloody undies, so what the fuck? I need to start tracking this. Shit, so 16 days ago. I got it 16 days ago. 16 fucking days ago. Fuck. I can't get pregnant. I can't. I have 4 more months of deployment at least. I'll start showing, right? Fuck, I don't even know when people start showing. Well, if anything, I know that when a baby comes 5 months after deployment, I'll be questioned and in some serious shit. But this happened to another girl and no one said anything to her. That baby was only a month early and still people talk. She's known as a slut. Fuck. I was even told about her.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.